this is the United Congregational Church of Holyoke, and wherever you are on your life's journey, you are welcome here. And I hope that you'll join us in fellowship hall after for a little coffee. And this is the time that we do our announcements, and I do have a couple for us this morning. The first is that we no longer are going to be passing around the microphone when it comes to the prayers of the people. So I do have index cards. They're right here at the front of the congregation. And we can get you an index card and just write legibly so that I can read it. And during the passing of the offering, you can just put your card right in there, and all of our prayers will be able to collect all of the prayers. And the second thing that I have, and just in case you didn't know, this is my favorite season. It is fall, and I love the weather. I love the fruit in the fall. And I have been made aware of a sculpture trail in East Hampton. We're going to have some maps on the board outside. And I have been led to believe that this will be a great day to go and do this. You might need some walking shoes on, see some sculptures. They are, I understand, absolutely gorgeous. This is done every other year in East Hampton. And there is some pears and some apples and some treats for sale on the farm. So I should be able to see everybody there this afternoon in the bright sunshine. Help us to be still. For in being still, in refusing to panic or despair, we shall come to know that God is there, suffering along with us, waiting to show us stepping stones through the swirling waters and to help us sing a new song. Amen.
Thank you.
We bring to you our gifts. May they be consecrated to do the will that you need us to do in the world. And may we get tenfold what we have given to you today. Amen. They do not understand, and the load seems heavier. A man came running up to him, knelt down, and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "Only God is truly good. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. And you must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and your mother." "Teacher," the man replied, "I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young." Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. "There is still one thing you haven't done," he told him. "Go and sell all your possessions and give money to the poor, and you will have the treasure in heaven. And then come and follow me." As the man's face fell, he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God?" This amazed them. But Jesus said again, "Dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom of God. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were astounded. "Then who in the world can be saved?" they asked. Jesus looked at them intently and said, "Humanly speaking, it is impossible, but not with God, for with God, everything is possible." And then Peter began to speak up. "We've given up everything to follow you," he said. "Yes," Jesus replied. "And I assure you that everyone who has given up a house or brothers and sisters or mother or father or children or property for my sake and for the sake of the good news will receive now in return 100 times as many houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and property, along with persecution. And the world came that, and in the world to come, that person will have eternal life. But many of the greatest now will be least important then. And those who seem least important now will have the greatest then." The word of God for the people of God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable and pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. So the scripture this morning from Mark is a little vague. I can envision a wealthy man asking Jesus what he can do, and all I can hear is yada, 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 because I was lost at a wealthy man. But my attention picked back up when I heard Jesus' response. So it got me thinking. I envisioned this as sort of a job evaluation. I can envision myself sitting across from Jesus being evaluated. And so this is going to be a job evaluation. We need to know what the questions that we're going to be asked are. So as every good employer would do, I looked up on Google the questions that I would be asked in a job evaluation and was not given as much questions as much as how they should be addressed. So we'll take it from that perspective. The first one says, use specific examples to back up claims. I'm giving Jesus a fail on this one. He gives no real evidence of what it is that we have failed at. He tells us what we need to do. He tells us what we need to do, but he's admittedly a little vague. I mean, for the wealthy guy in our scripture, maybe this is pretty clear. Give up your house, your boat, your cell phone, your new car, your housekeeper, I need to give up everything. I mean, what I have is not new or fancier. So we're just going to give a pass on this question. We'll go back to that a little bit later. And I'm going to skip over that commandment thing about whether we follow the commandments, because I don't think we need to touch that quite yet. We'll get there. I'm still stuck on selling everything. So if I sell everything, then what? Do I live in my car? Do I still get to have chocolate from time to time? Can I go out to dinner? I mean, I do work hard. What does everything mean? Is it everything or just everything? I have downsized recently, so my everything has already been kind of just a little bit smaller everything. So I'm really not sure what Jesus really means on this one. So I'm not sure as an employer he's doing a really good job at telling us what we really need to do. So, the next thing is, think of your statements as starting points. Elaborate on rather than end the discussion. Okay, so maybe all of these things that he said that we need to do are just starting points for what we need to discuss while we're sitting down. So, let's go a little bit. If he was here, and you could follow and learn to live a different life, that might be okay. But life is a little bit different than it was back then. You know, we're looking at things now in a 21st century lens, and the church that he wanted to create has been created. So, do we get a pass? I mean, we could live in a commune, or cloistered society, which admittedly has some upsides too, but I'm pretty sure that my new iPhone is not in that list. So then, this is a good one for an employer. Directly connect an employee's actions and their outcomes. Listen effectively. Be a rather good listener. Well, this is one thing I think we can give Jesus a good attaboy at. He does that pretty good. He connected back in verse 21, and he said, it was very clear, it said, he looked at them and loved him. So we know that Jesus has the ability to connect. So that at least is a little bit something we can work with. So now we have to go look at our actions and how we're going to be graded. We kind of glossed over that. Remember when I said we're not going to discuss all those commandment stuff? He was very particular. He did not mention the Ten Commandments. He picked out a handful of them. And while they all are important, we'll just glance over the ones that he decided to pick. And I'm going to start with this one, thou shalt not steal. I mean, I don't see any bank robbers here today, so I mean, does this really affect us? I don't know. But let's look a little bit deeper on thou shalt not steal. I don't think that it is about stealing in general. I think it's about creating a culture that theft isn't inherently built into. If we abide by that, we would have all folks earning a living wage. And while I'm not going to name names, Jeff Bezos, he isn't actually stealing money outright. But let this just sit here for a minute. In 2018, every 11.5 seconds, every 11.5 seconds, he made the yearly salary of his hourly employees. Every 11.5 seconds. So I'm not going to say that that is out there stealing, but I am going to say that his employees have $15 an hour. And I'm not saying that he isn't entitled to a living wage, and I'm not saying that he's not entitled to the fortunes that he has. I'm just saying that for every 11.5 seconds, he's made the amount of his lowest paying employees. I have a roof over my head. I have food in my cabinets. But I have to tell you, this is the one thing that I'm really having a hard time with. And I guess because I just never considered stealing above, don't take something that's not yours. And so, if I am going to put Jeff Bezos out there for taking something that I don't think is necessarily his, where does that leave me as a Christian? When I pull out of the parking lot today, and I drive down the street, and I get to go on the highway, and there's a panhandler there, where does that leave me? Do I give what I have? How is that any different than what I'm asking Jeff Bezos to do? As a Christian, I think that's very much the same. Does that mean I need to give him all my money? Do I need to make it fair? Do I need to provide him food? Well, what else is it that I could do? Well, I'm not here to judge that person's life, but I do keep a few things in my car to give somebody else a chance. Lately, it's been cans. I've been collecting my cans, and I give them out to somebody so that they can go and earn their own money. That gives that person the dignity to go and get their money as well. As I said, I don't know how much of that we need to include in thou shalt not steal, but the longer I sit with it, the more and more it resounds in me. It's not a perfect solution, but I have to think that to my boss who's sitting across from me and giving my evaluation at least knows that I try. So maybe I'll get a check mark on that part. Some of the other commandments that he listed are a little bit easier. You shall not commit murder. Well, that's pretty self-explanatory, right? But is it? I mean, we don't get up in the morning and think, I'm not going to kill somebody today, unless you have a teenager at home. But you know, I get up in the morning and I get in my car. We have the ability to take someone's life by the way that we drive. So maybe as we get into our car, maybe we need to say a prayer that we drive safely and that everybody else is driving safely too. Thou shalt not commit adultery. That one, I'm pretty sure that we can all agree that we can take care of that one. So that we'll leave that one in, but we'll just give ourselves a check on that one. But this other one here is a little bit more problematic. You shall not bear false witness. You know, for a long time, I thought that I could just say, yeah, I'm good with that one. I don't say lies out of gripes at anybody. Well, this week I actually looked up the definition of what that actually means. It means not to lie to someone or to cause harm. And I don't do that. But I'm going to give you two words. Social media. Just going to leave it there. What we put out there on social media can be interpreted by the person reading it as is the truth, whether it is or isn't, whether it's something that we say about our own lives or something that we say about the community. We can see that in the way the vaccine has made its way through social media and how how divisive it has created us to be. Honor your mother and father. I thought this was an interesting one that he put out there. Because, you know, honor your mother and father. You know, in our 21st century world, we don't put a lot of emphasis on this. You know, parents are there. I mean, my son would tell me that I'm there, but I don't think he sees me as a person. I mean, I'm just there. But, you know, honor your mother and father back in Jesus' time, that was a big deal. That is a really big deal. I mean, once his mother and father got to a certain age, who was going to care for them? When Joseph was no longer able to be a carpenter, we don't know what happened to him. Do you think that we don't know that what he was able to do for his entire life. So honor your mother and father. I think we have a long way to go in the way that we treat people that are elderly. And I think that is really, really into this one. I think it's far more about just respecting our parents. And I sit there and I watch the news sometimes, and I'm sure I'm not the only one who does this, and it isn't just the news, it's just TV. And I think, oh, their mother must be so proud. And you know, a lot of times I say that in a very negative way, but as I was writing this, I happened to be watching something on, you know, social media, and Simone Biles was on there, and I had to think, boy, her mother must be real proud for her to take the world stage like she did and be an advocate for mental health. Boy, that must be amazing. And you know, respecting her parents came right into that decision because she was given the freedom to be able to make those decisions by the people who raised her. And so here I am. I've gone through my job evaluation with Jesus. And I'm not quite sure where I stand. I'm not a wealthy person, so I haven't given everything. I've given a lot, but not everything. I mean, following the commandments, you know, we can all agree that that's not that hard of a thing to do. Do not have any other gods but me. That, you know, that's a pretty easy one, right? We probably can all get a check mark on that one. But, you know, as I know I've said this before, I really like a new cell phone. And I have to say, the fact that I like my gadgets and have no other gods before me, sometimes I have to pull back on what my wants are in order to make sure that I'm not worshiping my Apple products as much as that I really shouldn't be. So here we go. We're told to give up everything, so we're gonna sit here. I'm sure everybody has a piece of paper and a pen ready, right? We're gonna take our inventory. And where do we rate ourselves? Do you rate yourself a 10? A 5? Is attending church every week enough for us to say that we're following Jesus? Is it enough to make sure that we maintain the commandments as they're written? Well, most of those I can check okay, but all of them? I think one of those things that we need to do in our lives that brings us humility is to sit down and take check of where we are in our lives and job evaluation a little bit easier. Because surely Jesus is not talking about my quilting needles, which are teeny, teeny, tiny. But it is not a camel that the translation of the word camel is very similar to the word rope. So, we have hope, my friends. It might not be easy to get that rope through my needle, but there is a chance that we can do it. But what do we have to do to get there? So, yesterday, I came across the poem that Amanda Gorman read on January 20th. And the two last lines of her poem are very pertinent to where we are today and whether we are going to make it to the kingdom of God. And she said,